person and online. If you're visiting with us, please fill out the perforated part of the bulletin and place in the offering. We'd like to get to know you better. The dates for VBS are set. VBS will be Sunday, July 14th through Wednesday, July 17th from 6 to 8 p.m. We need many volunteers. So. Let me know if you're interested in volunteering. If you're not, you'll probably get asked anyway, so you might as well just volunteer. Now, the adults always have just as much fun as the kids, so it's always a good time for all ages. And this year, the theme is Shine Jesus' Light. This VBS will rocket the youth over the moon on an out-of-this-world adventure, shining Jesus' light. Let us enter into worship.
Thank you. strength, we know that all will be well. Our asking most of the time is about ourselves, what we need. But then there are some times when we ask about how we could be obedient children, how we could serve you more fully. And when we do that, we pray that you would answer us with clarity, so that our busy minds would work through all the clouds and clutter of life to find your path. And when we listen to your voice, and when we are obedient, we know that you would dwell in us as we dwell in you. Abide with us, O living God, and may we abide in you. And when that relationship is substantial, our lives are secure, we can walk through the valley of darkness and we will not fear evil. So this morning, we come before you as asking, seeking, knocking people, knowing that your steadfast love endures forever. During this time of worship, we ask that you would sanctify the moment and the space. You would reveal yourself to us. And in your presence, we would ask for more. We would talk to you about the lack of peace in our world, asking that you would intervene. We even would wonder why, in the midst of all the abundance, there are so many needs that go unanswered. And when you respond, you may call us to do more and to walk humbly in your presence. And when you call us to be good disciples, may we have the hearts to yield. When we come before you, we will talk about all the things that we lack, but at the same time, point out to us all the blessings in our lives, so that we will live in your presence with gratitude. During this time of worship, we pray for those who are ill, people who are in hospitals, people who have been forgotten, those who are grieving. Our personal prayers we bring before you. Accept us as we are. Bless us, hold us together. For the joy of Madison and the Christian Church, we give you thanks. Bind us together by your love. Point us in directions where we would glorify your holy name. Continue to be with us throughout this worship service. Hear us even now as we join in the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
love one another just as he has commanded us. All who keep his commandments abide in him, and he in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit which he has given us. This is the word of God.
Thank you.
We don't even try to explore our relationship with God in tangible terms. We come up with easy phrases that we can pick out of the Bible that does not require much of us, and we think God is pleased. This text says no. To be restless about our relationship with God, there is something about it. Hang with me on this. The senior minister of Madison Avenue Baptist Church in Manhattan, New York. You thought there were no Baptists in Manhattan, right? Because I'm a Baptist woman. Sorry. The senior minister of Madison Avenue Baptist Church in Manhattan, New York, says this. It is important for us to constantly have this question when it comes to our relationship with God and our conversation with God, which is why she's saying that people of faith grow and mature in faith, and they have assurance with Christ because they continue to ask that question, why? Why is there so much war in this world? Why, in the midst of all the abundance, there are so many need? Why are things happening to me this way? And she goes on further to say, we need to push that question a little further. And let me do that. When it comes to serving God, do we really ask the why question? When I was in Vancouver Christian Church in Washington State, sometimes we would take the youth group on work camp. And one summer we took the youth group to Yakima, Washington for a work camp. And the kids were having fun. The job was to clean yards for elderly people. We didn't know whose yard was owned by an elderly person. So we would just go knock at the door and ask them if we could. Usually after our work trip in the evening, we would sit and talked about the day's experience and what about it had anything to do with your faith. How does that make you a person who comes closer to God? So as we were talking, one of our young people said, well, I have a question. I don't know if it's the right question for me to ask about my service today. As I'm cleaning this yard, and there was a lot of clutter, and I'm glad you folks gave us gloves and all that. So I was cleaning this yard, I am looking through the window, and inside the house, the whole family, they have kids, they are all able-bodied people, and they're sitting there watching TV and eating McDonald's. Is it okay? Is it okay for them to be eating McDonald's and I have to clean their house? To ask questions about our faith life and what our faith calls us to do. Do we simply say, well, no, you know, somewhere I was told I'm not supposed to ask all those questions. I just do whatever I am told to do. So we started talking. Yeah. What if God showed us grace that way of what we deserve and what we're capable of? It didn't satisfy me when I knew my very biblical pastoral life did not do anything. That kid was still shaking his head.
kids have come to be part of you and to make your community better, and they do it. Is it okay to ask questions about what God calls us to do? What Jesus said, if you love me, you keep my commandments. And if you love me and if you want to keep my commandments, you won't just talk, you do. To take God for granted. And to just go through an insipid, boring faith journey. There is so much excitement about our faith. Provided we ask that question, why? If God is present, why is this so much trouble? What am I missing? What have I not been able to see and do? How do I find out God's nature by the way I live my faith? Is God revealed in how I live my faith? How I love God, love neighbor? Can I grow in my faith? It was a beautiful day, Saturday. I'm coming to church because I'm usually here on Saturday morning, getting ready for a final round. That's when I look at that sermon and say, "Are you going to preach this one?" And I come to the stop sign off of Route 75, and there is this guy standing there wanting. I'm pretty smart. My rational mind always knows what to do when I come there. Don't look at them. Look at them, you're in trouble. And then my smart mind also knows this. Rationalize it. And you need to think about your service and the impact it makes, whether it has positive impact, negative impact. And I thought, no. If I give money, you know, we all know that. We know that routine. And then I thought about Diane, who sometimes would take food after Monday night dinners and give it to folks who are standing who are parked there under the bridge who have signs. But again, you know, that is a better way to do it. But something in me said, no. Come on. Do it. So I load my window, give it out, and the guy is smiling. And then looking through the sign, one after the other, the windows are opening. And people are starting to give the guys, and it's a lovely thing. And it's a chain reaction. And I thought I did something. And then I get on the highway, and I realize I just discovered the nature of God, God's generosity, the abundance of grace. It is, if God were to sit and rationalize and say, "I don't think I should do this for you. If I did this for you, you're going to mess yourself up." God's abundant grace and abundant giving it just pours. And it happens something like that, where God turns off rational, deductive reasoning, trying to analyze it. Oh, you need to have an analytical life, but rest easy. Asking questions, wanting to find out. We ask questions about everything. Well, here's a good suggestion I'll give you. Anymore, before I go to the doctor's office, I write all my questions down. Because I go there and I see that white coat and that person starts talking fast, I forget everything. Boom, it's gone. So after they finish talking, I say, "Wait a minute, I've got questions for you. Here it is." We do that. We do that about our financial planning. We do that about our vacation planning. We do all the analysis, everything, inventory. How about our faith journey, our relationship with God? Do we ask the awkward questions? Is there a restlessness about us that we try to explore? restless hearts. And in our restless questioning, we find and we explore says there was a small blind girl in Copenhagen who was leading a group of beggars who were musicians, and they came to the town square and they started playing their music, and there were a lot of people who gathered around who were listening to the music, but they were all the ones who were listening to the music, they had nothing to give. But they were listening to the music. Kierkegaard says, they were the wealthy, the beautiful people who were on the way to the opera. And when they were going in their chariots to the opera, they just didn't even bother to turn and look. They just kept going. And these poor people who didn't have anything to give were just standing there. And Kierkegaard says, that is sometimes how our relationship with God and service with God happens. Some have it, but they won't. Some do not, but they will. God's kingdom rests upon that dilemma, that there are people
trust God enough to help us step forward or to provide us when we need to lay down our apprehensions and reach out for a moment? Have we as individuals become a community of bystanders, a TV or stadium audience looking for a distance? Don't we know that God wants us to be in His game? We all know there's not an 11th commandment to sit and watch. Mark Twain said, actions speak louder than words, but not nearly as often. For the one in need, inaction can be frighteningly loud. Love others as you love us. We ask this in Christ's name.